This is Jim Cornette. You're listening to InYourHeadOnline.com, and you made the right choice.
All right, we are back, and we're joined by Tank Toland. Welcome to In Your Head.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Yeah, thanks for coming on. We're just going over the names, and I think Tank, that he was originally going to use one-inch biceps as his in-ring name.
Who, me?
Yeah.
One-inch biceps. I'm not sure about one-inch biceps. You know, I might be a little, you know, some people got the pythons. I might have garden snakes. I don't know, but, you know. I think I'm not that far off, you know. I think 20-inch guns aren't that bad.
Yeah.
No Hogan 24-inch, but, you know.
I've seen Incher in person. It's like calling, like, a real tall guy short.
Yeah,
he's just built. Right. Actually, we got a caller here already. Who is this?
This is Eric.
We got Eric Langley on the phone here.
What's up,
Eric Langley? Huh?
Mm-hmm.
How are you, sir? What's going on, my man?
Not a lot. I just, as a fellow In Your Head alumnus, I thought I'd call in and at least give my 2 cents for a couple minutes.
Oh, cool, man. How you doing?
How have you been?
This is ETV. ETV's the man.
Yeah. Right, everybody can check out the archive of Eric Langley on InYourHeadOnline.com.
I did the show a couple months ago, and I enjoyed it. So I wanted to call in and talk to Tank for a minute and just say hello to everybody.
All right. So what's your question, man?
I didn't really have a specific question. I guess how Tank's been doing since he's been. I hear that he may be running the amateur class there at OVW. How's that been going?
That's good. Actually, I am running the amateur class in OVW. I'm one of the head instructors there at OVW, and it was a real good opportunity that Danny Davis, who is the owner and operator of OVW, gave me the opportunity to do that. And I've been having a lot of fun, man, with it. Breaking in the new people that are just getting into business, showing them what it's all about, as far as how hard it is to just do what we do. And I think a lot of them are having a new appreciation for what it is to become a professional wrestler, because, a lot of people, before they even step foot in the ring, they think, hey, I could do that, I see what they're doing, I can do that, and then they don't realize how hard it is until they actually jump in the ring. So I'm glad that I could be one of those people who's shown just how tough it is, because you have to have real appreciation and respect for the business, especially if you want to do something like this. So it's been a blast, man.
And if I know you well enough, you'll break them in just like you did that chair over Chris Cage last year, whenever that was.
Yeah, that's actually going on 2 years ago now.
Been that long? Wow.
Yeah, I smashed Cage with the chair, and at the same time I smashed him in the back of the chair. I tore my bicep and put me out for about a good 3 months. So.
Good thing you had a good trainer there to treat you when that happened.
Yeah, thank goodness. I don't know who that guy was, so I'm going to have to thank him. No, I'm just kidding. That's you. Yeah, you silly bastard.
Hey, well, thank you. I'll see you. I get on with your interview. I just wanted to call in and say hello.
All right. Thanks a lot for calling in.
Talk to you soon.
Yeah. You'll be entered in our Royal Rumble contest. I'll pick your number later on in the show.
Oh, that'll work.
All right.
Thanks.
He mentioned that you're a trainer enough in OVW.
Yeah, that's correct. Yep.
And you were talking about, people who love wrestling and everything. Do you think someone who comes into wrestling, who grew up like a fan of wrestling, has a better chance of making it than like somebody who just comes in trying to make some money?
Well, I definitely think it's a big benefit, because, for one thing, you're going to understand, when you watch wrestling, and if you're a fan of it, and you become not only a fan, but kind of a critic, in some ways, because you see what you like, what you don't like. You see the characters you like, what you don't like about the characters, what you do like about the characters. You kind of get your own ideas of what you would like to be if you were a wrestler, and the kinds of things they do, you kind of get ideas. And wrestling is so history rich, as you know, that it's important to know the history. Out of, just so you could become a better wrestler, but also out of total respect for the business. So, I always tell all my students, you got to have a respect for the history of wrestling. You got to know who has come before you and laid the path that you're able to now go down. And, you got to show the respect and know who's who and who's done what for the business. So not only so you can become a better wrestler, but just, out of respect. So, yeah, I think definitely it benefits you to be a fan your whole life. I was a fan my whole life, and I see some other people that, you know, not all, always are, have been fans their whole life, but they've had the opportunity come upon them the way they've, you know, been given contracts and because of their look, and yet they don't exactly, you know, have an understanding of wrestling because they haven't been fans. You know, and some people, you know, some people that, you know, I'm not putting it against them, you know, some people get the opportunity, even though they weren't fans their whole life, they grow up with an appreciation for it, and that's cool. But I think it definitely helps to be a fan. But mm-hmm. not always doesn't always necessarily mean that's going to make you or break you.
Right. I know, like, they would say Kurt Angle wasn't a fan of pro wrestling, but, you know, he became one of the best and really studied.
Yeah, I mean, he didn't do too bad for himself, right?
Right.
Yeah, I mean, he caught on. I mean, look at the guy. He became one of the best in the modern era. So, I mean, he's a phenomenal talent. And, I mean, that goes to show you that, you know, you don't always necessarily have to be a fan of the sport your whole life, but it's someone that is a phenomenal athlete and was able to adapt from the amateur wrestling to professional. And during that adaptation, he actually gained great respect and a love for the business, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So you know, that's a prime example of someone that doesn't necessarily have to be a fan your whole life. So,
what do you see like for like young people trying to get into wrestling? Like the biggest mistake that they make?
I mean, there's different mistakes that you can make, but I would have to say the most common would be not knowing what you're getting yourself into. I mean, people see what's going on the independents. And you got a bunch of kids out there who are going on the independents with very or little, no training, or just the wrong training, and they're going out there and putting on shows and doing all kinds of crazy stuff, you know, risking life and limb for a couple bucks or sometimes even for free. And, you know, you got fans out there that are impressionable, and they're thinking, hey, well, if that guy's out there in a white beater and a pair of jeans, hey, I could do it too. You know, fat and out of shape or skinny and you know, got nothing to them. And I'm not saying that you have to be, you know, in the best shape, but, you know, there's sometimes a certain part you should look, you know, and if it's not as far as being in shape, it's, you know, the way you're dressed, you know, a certain ring attire. And I think a lot of people, you know, see people out there that are just, you know, like I said, in the tank top and jeans or whatever they, you know, can throw on. And, you know, not in shape or anything, but going out there doing crazy stuff, I think they get the wrong idea that they can just go out there and do it too. So I think people getting into the business, you know, all the young guys or girls getting into the business, I think they should understand that, you know, the way to really do it and do it right is to find a school that has proper credentials, people that have been places, have done things, that have, you know, success rate, and that, mm-hmm. that know what they're doing. And so, you know, if you really want to do it, you got to have 110% dedication and passion for the business, because otherwise it's going to be way too tough. And I've had too many people come into my class and find out the hard way that it's not just fun and games. You're not just going to come in there and learn how to do all the stuff, you know, all the moves and everything like that. There comes a lot of conditioning and a lot of hard work and a lot of sacrifice to be able to get to the top. And even the best don't always make it to the top, you know? So mm-hmm. so you gotta be patient.
Oh, when you first went to OVW, who would you say, like, was most helpful guys there for you?
Oh, man. Well, I mean, like, when I was lucky enough to get accepted into OVW, Jim Cornette was the main guy that brought me in, and he put me right to a tag team with another wrestler who was under developmental contract for a while, Chris Cage, and we were a team called Adrenaline, and we were really lucky and got to win the tag belts on several occasions as tag titles, and I learned so much from him because he's a manager of some of the greatest tag teams. So I learned so much about tag team psychology and just wrestling psychology and promo psychology and all the other stuff. I've learned so much from him. I learned from Rip Rogers a great deal. Lance Storm was one of the best trainers I've ever had, and Al Snow was great. I mean, I'd say that some of the guys that were there too were very influential at the time that were still getting ready to go up, like Nova, who was, you know, Simon Dean,
mm-hmm.
who actually is a great talent, and you know, they could have done so much more with him. But I mean, like guys like him and Doug Basham, Nick Dinsmore, Lance Cade, Rob Conway, you know, there were a lot of guys there that were there just as I was coming in, that were getting ready to go up, that I learned a lot from. And then you'd have the agents come back down from the WWE and some of the other guys that I got to work when I first got there, like Randy Orton and Billy Kidman and some of the other guys, Billy Gunn, and you know, a lot of the guys that would come down, I got to learn different things from people here and there. So I mean, it was fantastic to learn from everybody. That's the great thing about OVW is you have so many people coming through there. Bradshaw was there on a lot of occasions when he'd be coming down just to get back in shape or rehab or whatever it was. So I mean, we had a lot of people that would be able to come down and critique us and give us their feedback. So I mean, there's just too many people to thank for what I've learned when I got to OVW.
Mm-hmm. Jim Cornette's always known for managing like some great tag teams. Did he ever come up with any of your double team maneuvers?
He would definitely come up with different things. I mean, different ideas for matches. He'd come up with some ideas here and there for matches. Chris Cage used to do a rocket launcher type of situation. Chris Cage would throw me off the top rope, I'd hit a crossbody or splash onto a guy, you know, that kind of stuff. I mean, different things that you might have seen done with you know, the Midnight Express or the Rock and Roll Express or whoever else, anyone else that he might have had, had dealings with that, you know, we definitely used some of their stuff. And, you know, he always had great ideas, though. I mean, it's always a guy that had, he's a genius. He's an encyclopedia of wrestling, so...
Yeah.
You know, he would always be having us try things that, he'd pull out of his bag from the old days.
Yeah, because we were at a Q&A, a live Q&A with the Midnight Express at the Fan Fest, and they said that a lot of the double team maneuvers that they did, like Cornette actually thought up.
So. Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, sure. Sure, I mean, there's a lot of things. And then, then later on, we did a move, you know, the Vegematic.
Right.
The Vegematic where I would hold the guy over my legs and then Chad just dropped the leg drop from the top rope. You know, that was a nice move.
Mm-hmm.
I think actually that might have been one that Cornette actually thought of.
Yeah. When you guys first came in, I remember
Cornette's got a million different moves up his sleeve, a million different ideas. So, I mean, like I said, he's an encyclopedia of wrestling. He knows it all.
Yeah.
So.
I remember when you guys came in and you guys were doing that. Not, you know, I thought right away the Vegematic, but I remember some people of mine were saying you guys were copying America's Most Wanted.
Hold on, man. Hold on.
All right.
Awesome. Oh my God. Hold on.
All right.
Huh?
Hello. Can you hear us?
Hold on.
All
yeah,
right.
Hold on. I got your head. It's on my Bluetooth. Hold on.
What do you think? Hello.
Hold up there. I got you now.
All right. Cool.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, man.
That's okay.
You got transferred to my Bluetooth somehow. Can you still hear me as well?
Yeah. Not as well, but we can still hear you.
All right. I'm sorry about that, man.
That's
okay. You got transferred to my Bluetooth.
What's that?
Somehow. Yeah. All right. I'm sorry. So where did I leave off at all?
I was just talking about Jim Cornette. I was saying, I remember when you guys first came in as the Dicks and you guys were doing that move, and I thought right away the Vegematic, and I remember some people online were saying that you guys copied it from America's Most Wanted. I just thought it was kind of funny because, you know, Midnight Express made that move popular years before.
Absolutely. We actually, to be honest with you, I didn't even know that that America's Most Wanted did that.
Mm-hmm.
To be honest with you, I mean, no disrespect to them, but I just didn't know that they were doing that. So, I mean, if anything, the way we ended up doing it, Cornette didn't even give that to us, really. You know, actually, at the time, Cornette had already been gone, and Paul Heyman was writing TVs, and we were actually working the Dudley Boys, and Bubba and Devon were like, hey, well, look, let's give you guys a double team finish that would be good to use since you guys aren't the tallest guys that could be impactful, though.
Mm-hmm.
And so they said, hey, well, you know, they actually were, you know, we were like, what can we do? And like, and I said, hell, well, probably something from the top rope would be good then, since, you know, it can give us, you know, a leverage, you know, since we'd be coming from a higher position than, you know, standing, because we're not the tallest guys. And he said, okay, well, and then we thought about it. And then I think it was actually Bubba that ended up thinking, hey, well, what about the Vegematic? And so, you know, we did that. And we hit the Vegematic on Bubba first during an OVW match when we beat them. So, I mean, it was, you know, that was the first time we used it. So I think it was actually Bubba that thought, hey, why don't you guys use that? Yeah.
One of our fans, Jason, asked, what was the best piece of advice that Cornette gave you?
Well, I'm sorry, you, it was a little muffled, what was that?
Right, one of our fans, Jason, wants to know, what was the best piece of advice Jim Cornette gave you?
Oh man, jeez, he gave me so much good advice. I would have to say that some of the best advice that he gave me was, you know, be patient. Be patient was one of the best pieces of advice he gave me. Because you know, I was always trying to, you know, want this and that earlier before I should have things, and I agree. And sorry about that, I'm a little distracted for a second. So I'd say patience, and another thing was he would always say, don't believe it until you've been there, you've done it, you've seen it on TV, you've gotten the paycheck, and it didn't bounce. So that's another little wrestling thing, a little bit of knowledge you passed on to me.
Yes, I bring this up. This guy in the chat room keeps wanting to mention that he's in the chat room. It's Quick Nunzio from the cruise, and he says, what's up?
I want to say what's up, a big what's up to Nunzio. What's up, big nun? What's up, big nun? Yeah, don't worry, Nuns. I was going to give you a shout-out before the interview was over. I know. It's been long overdue. I know.
Oh, so there's someone you know. It's not just...
No. Me and Nunzio go way back, man. That's one of my boys right there, man.
Oh, okay.
Nunzio is a good guy, man. Good guy, good family. So, yeah, what's up, Nuns? Hey, Nuns, get me booked on that show if it goes down, all right? All right.
Do we get a commission on that booking?
That's just something that's gone way back. He's still working on something to do something for the school. For his school, so. Yeah.
He asked another question here. I don't know if you want to answer it or whatever. He said, yes, he wants me to ask why you punched Chad Wakes in the face.
That's kind of a long story. But I'll give you the short version, basically. He had a lot of heat with a lot of guys when we were up there. He just rubbed people the wrong way and made some very poor choices. And he let people get on him, and he let it bother him too much. And one thing led to another, where he let them goat him into sucker punching me a couple times, and I had to defend myself. And when I defended myself, I had to beat him up. And that's what I did. I beat him up and knocked him out, and then, of course, a month later, we got released.
So, do you think that was what led to it?
No, I don't think that's necessarily 100% of what led to it. I mean, let's be honest, the Dicks wasn't exactly the best gimmick in the world to be given.
Right.
So, I'm so thankful for the opportunity I had in WWE. I mean, it was great, and if I ever got the opportunity to get up there again and work for them, it'd be fantastic. But at the same time, when I went up there with Chad, I knew they had me and Chad and I together for a good, you know, almost a year before they brought us up, and I told many people from the trainers to the agents and everybody else knew that. If Chad and I were just oil and, like, we were oil and water. We just didn't mix. We didn't have any chemistry. We had horrible chemistry. And I tried to let people know that, but we still got brought up into tag team. And to make matters worse, you know, a month into it, after you know, we'd done our run-ins, no one knew who we were. They, you know, we were approached by certain people of influence who said, we're going to call you the Dicks. And I was like, and you guys are going to dress up like Chippendales and strip off your clothes? And I was like, all right, well, okay. I just smiled and tried to make the best of it. Inside, I was kind of like, oh, my gosh, this is a curse. I was like, this is going to be dead in the water. I know it. I was like, you know, and I actually had some concerns because they're already doing like a dancer stripper gimmick with the Heart Rods on Raw.
Mm-hmm.
So I was like, oh, man.
was like, all right. I kind of voiced my concern on that, but they're like, oh, no, no, it's going to be totally different. It's going to be edgy, and it's going to be different, you know? And I'm like, all right. So, you know, I give it my best, and, you know, but you can only get so much away with so much on network television. You can't, you know, you can barely even get away with even saying the word dick on network television.
Right.
You know, that's something that's going to be on, that's something that's going to be on cable, like Raw. You know, mm-hmm. if it was on Raw, it might have been a little bit different because you could be more risque with it, you know? You
right.
could have really, you know, done a little bit more. But let's face the fact, the dicks, you can only go so far with it. It's a ha-ha, it's ha-ha, and then it gets old.
Yeah,
so,
it's kind of a one-joke name.
Yeah, it had a limited shelf life. I mean, let's be real about it. So I would have loved a different opportunity, but that's what I got, and I tried to do the best with what I got, you know?
Mm-hmm. So, well, there's been a lot of guys who were given, you know, not so great gimmicks, and you know, like Al Snow or Kane or whatever, you know, eventually they gave him something that fit them better.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, and when we got released, you know, we were told, like, hey, you know, the gimmick just didn't get over the way we wanted it to, and I voiced my concerns, like, well, it wasn't exactly the best gimmick, you know, and it could have been done a little bit better. I mean, we should have been doing more backstage stuff to help get the characters over.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of, you know, just going out there and wrestling, because, you know, who are the dicks? No one knew who the dicks were. All they saw was us going out there dancing, but then when it came time to wrestle, we wrestled like everybody else,
right.
You know? And that's partly our fault for not being different when we were wrestling, but when you have a six-minute match and you're supposed to do it, you're told, you know, you can only do so much. So, I mean, it's hard sometimes to get a character over if you're not feeling like you're getting the right opportunities to get it over, you know?
Oh.
You know.
So no plans of doing the Dicks gimmick on the indie scene?
What's that?
No plans of bringing the tag team back on, like, the indie scene.
Oh, shit. Hell no. Are you kidding me? That was dead, gone, buried, and glad to bury it. As soon as I got, you know, I'll tell you what, the only good thing that came out of getting released from the WWE was that I never had to do that Dicks gimmick again. Oh, God. I was just glad. And even better so was that I didn't ever have to have Chad as my partner again. You know, so those were some anchors and some curses that I was glad to get rid of. So, I mean, that was the only good part of getting released from the WWE was that I didn't have to be that gimmick and be with that partner anymore. Other than that, man, I miss the WWE. So it's a little bit. I'll get sometimes. The WWE, I wish I could still be there, but, you know, sometimes that's just the way it goes, you know. And meanwhile, I'm having a lot of fun on the independents. I've gotten some opportunities to wrestle some other great, talented people. For people like in Ring of Honor and things such as that now I'm learning some new styles and things like that. So, I mean, you know, it's a blessing in disguise, but at the same time, I'd still love to be wrestling with the WWE.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think, you know, that could help you get back in WWE eventually if you learn some different styles and get a name for yourself on the indie scene.
I mean, yeah, I mean, like, you know, I definitely have, I mean, I've totally changed my look now. I have a different look. I have a different, you know, my wrestling style is changing. I have a different feel to myself, you know, as a character. And it's a little more similar to how I was in OVW before I got brought up and put in the dick, but it's a little bit more edgy, it's a little darker, and it's good, you know. It's, you know, a lot of people out there only know me as one of the dicks because, you know, they don't see the independents and they don't know OVW.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, the character I was on the dicks was so far from the character I am, you know, on the independent scene, and for who I am as a wrestler in general, that Dick character was 180 degrees different from who I am as a wrestler and as a person. So for me to do that character is very difficult.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, like I said, I was just happy to be up there and saying, yes, Mr. McMahon, whatever you want, Mr. McMahon, it's your toy, Mr. McMahon.
Right.
Yes, sir. Thank you for the paycheck, Mr. McMahon.
Do you prefer doing tag teams or singles?
Singles. I 100% love doing singles more than I do tag teams. I mean, you know, I don't get me wrong, I had fun doing tag teams. I had fun, you know, wrestling with different partners and having a good time and everything. But when it comes down to it, I mean, I really like doing singles because you're more in control of what goes on, what's happening. I mean, you don't have to worry about someone else messing up on your end. You know, if you go out there and you mess up, there's only two people to mess up instead of four, you know? Mm-hmm. And there's only two people thinking instead of four. So, I mean, I like to go in there and just be able to control what's going on and, you know, have more of a say and not have to worry about, is this spot is going to go right or is this match going to go right? You know, it's just, I can control the influences that are going on. You know, there's no outside interferences or no interference. You know, mm-hmm. just to determine whether my match is going to go good. If it's good, it's because of myself and the person I was working with and not a few other people, you know?
Right. Now, you mentioned about working for Ring of Honor. What is it like working in front of their Ring of Honor fans?
Oh, man, that fans are awesome. Oh, man, they hate me. I love it. The fans hate me, and I love it. I've got no problem with it. I mean, I knew that when I first was going to start working for Ring of Honor that they're going to hate me because I was coming from the WWE. It's mm-hmm. a totally different style, totally different flavor, and they only know me from being a dick or what I did in OVW or whatever. They mainly knew me as a dick from the WWE, and they hate the sports entertainment brand. They want their own, you know, they want their style, which is totally different. And you know what? I love their style. I think it's awesome. And that's why I love learning how to adapt to their style and do more of their style, because it's more of an international flavor. It's more of like a little bit of Japanese style, a little bit of the English mm-hmm. style, you know, different things, a little luchador, you know, it's a little bit of everything mixed in, and I love it. I think it's awesome. And to be honest, I wish there was more of that in the WWE. Because I think there's way too much talking in the WWE. I think there's not enough wrestling. And I think it, right now, the fans are boring, to be quite honest with you.
Mm-hmm.
That's my opinion. I think they could be doing so much better things, so many better angles. I think that they could be using people much better than what they're using. So, I mean, you know, it's ridiculous.
With Cornette?
Yeah, I love Ring of Honor, though.
Okay. I was just saying, with Cornette and TNA now, is there any, have you ever any talks about going to TNA?
I've talked to people here and there about it, and, you know, right now they still only have a one-hour TV show,
mm-hmm.
and I know they're going to try to eventually get to 2 hours, hopefully, but I mean, like, you know, they got a million people to use, and I've been talking to people and thinking about, you know, trying to get a shot down there. But right now, I'm still just hitting the indies and things like that, and I'm still in Louisville teaching, so it would be hard for me to go down there and do TNA unless I got a definite opportunity. I don't want to go just down there and do, like, one or two matches and just be here and there. I'd like actually want to be used in an angle or actually be used regularly. Give me something to leave here and go down there, you know. I don't want to just do it randomly, you know.
Right.
I'm enjoying teaching and doing things down here as well in Louisville. So.
How about Wrestling Society X? Do you think that has a chance of making it?
You know what? I haven't seen it yet. Has it been on yet?
I think they're going to air the first show.
Has it been, sure?
Yeah, it's January 30th. I think they're going to air the first one.
Because, I mean, I saw some of the previews for it, and I talked actually to one of the producers for it who was talking about having me do it a while ago, and he said if they do another season, they're wanting to use me. But, you know, I mean, I don't know where I'll be by that time if they decide to do another season. We'll see.
Right.
But, we'll see what happens. I mean, I don't know. From what I've heard from a couple of the wrestlers, the way they're filming it and what they're doing was a little crazy, it sounded like to me. So, I don't know. I'd have to see if it would be... I'll have to watch it and see if it's...
You can't really judge something until it's... you actually see it.
Yeah, I'm going to have to actually see it. You know, we'll see what it's all about. But I heard it's a little weird, a little crazy how they did it and everything like that.
I think it's
a little MTV-ish.
Right. Yeah, and I think it's only a half hour long.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so we'll see. We'll see what happens.
Did you have another question from the board, Incher?
I'm actually having technical difficulties.
Barbie. All right, well, how about Barbie?
Well, one of our fans, GoldGo13, wants to know what it was like working with Road Warrior Animal.
Oh, man. Oh, Animal's awesome, man. I mean, he's a great guy. I mean, not only that, he's, you know, tag team, he's a tag team legend. I mean, he's one of the most dominant tag teams of all time. So when the opportunity to work with him and Heidenreich, who I'd already, you know, worked a few times in OVW and stuff before he went up there, you know, I mean, it was just a great opportunity to be able to work. That was, I'll say that was one of the great things about being in a tag team, was that I got the chance to work Animal. And, you know, I got to learn some things from him. He's a great guy, great heart, and a giver in the business. You know, he wanted to really, you know, just give everything he could, as any knowledge he had. He wanted to try and pass it on to me and to Chad, not to Chad and you, but, you know, anyone here out the other with him. But, listen to me, Barry, I'm sorry about that. it was great. It was great working with Animal. He's a fantastic guy, and you know, it was phenomenal. Even though it wasn't the original Road Warriors, to be able to go in there and to work with Animal and to actually get to pin him, I mean, that was phenomenal. I mean, and in England too. I mean, you know, it was amazing. So I mean, great time. I got to take the finish a couple times. And it was just a phenomenal experience.
Mm-hmm. Any other legends you were in the ring with, like you kind of marked out for, maybe?
You know, I wouldn't say I actually marked out
right.
anyone in particular. You know, I would say the respect factor was definitely there, though. I mean, in your head, I mean, you're thinking, wow, man, this is a great opportunity. I mean, this is, you know, someone I got to watch growing up or something like that. You know, I mean, anytime
I
got
to meet... website.
What's that?
I thought you were plugging the website. You were saying in your head.
Oh, in your head, yeah. Well, yeah, well, there you go. See?
I was like, you're marking up for us?
We'll click that and make it seem...
I'm officially marking up for In Your Head Wrestling. Yes.
Yeah, we'll click that out and make it sound like you're big fans of ours.
.com, yes. And anytime I was in the ring with guys, like, especially like the agents, like, you know, Ricky Steamboat and Arn Anderson, guys like that, you know, I mean they'd be helping teach us, you know, giving us their ideas and their thoughts, their feedback, and everything. It was great. I mean, even guys like, you know, like Undertaker came down to OVW a couple times, and as well as when we were up there, I got to listen to him and learn from him. He pulled us off to the side a few times, and as well as you know, guys like Triple H and guys like that. You know, it was always great to be able to just listen to what they would say and try and soak in everything they have to give, because they're all such, you know, like, you know, like you said, legends and icons. And the people that, you know so much about the history and about the psychology and just about the business in general. So, I mean, it was always great to get in there and be able to learn from them and work with them in any capacity. I mean, even if it wasn't an actual match, but just training, and they get in there and train with us sometimes going before shows. It was just, it's phenomenal to be able to do that. So, yeah, deep appreciation. I wouldn't exactly necessarily say call it marking out, but definitely a major respect factor. And you know who you're in there with, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So,
anybody currently in OVW, maybe some people don't know about, that you think we should look out for in the future?
Well, Paul Burchill is back down in OVW. And I think everybody remembers Paul with the pirate gimmick,
mm-hmm.
Which was another fantastic WWE idea. Right. I'm not bad mouthing the WWE, because I think they've come up with some absolutely fantastic ideas. But at the same time, I think, you know, sometimes they throw things at the wall, and if something doesn't stick right away, they want to just move on from it, and they don't want to take time to develop something.
Mm-hmm.
They're scared. But the fact is sometimes you got to, if it's a gimmick, you got to get it over. It takes time to get it over sometimes. Not everything's going to be the boogeyman and just get over right away. You know what I mean?
Right.
And so sometimes some things take time to nurture and to let it grow. You know, people just don't always take the things right away. It takes time. But I think you know, I'll get off there because you asked me another question, so I'll go back to the question. But, you know, Paul Versus one that I think is going to come back and make an impact if they let him. Another guy down there right now, Seth Skyfire, who he's more of a cruiserweight. He's more of a flyer, but I mean he's very athletic, very talented. He's got great psychology, and I think he's got the opportunity to do a lot. I mean, he's got Jacob Duncan, who's a big man. He's more of like, you know, an Undertaker size type guy, big guy. You know, I mean, there's just a lot of guys down there right now who have potential, and I think it's just a matter of how the WWE decides to use them in what capacity and what role. Mm-hmm. You know, so I mean, you know, Vince is usually all about the big guy, you know, and but not always the big guy isn't always the best wrestler. We know that, you know, that's a fact. Some of the best wrestlers are the ones that are 6 foot and under. You know, I mean, Kurt Angle, you know, Shawn Michaels. Mm-hmm. I mean, these are, I mean, some of the best wrestlers are, you know, just under six foot. You know, Benoit. You know, Eddie Guerrero. I mean, you could just, you know, the list goes on. I mean, of great wrestlers who aren't always tall. But, you know, he likes the big guys, so he usually pushes the big guys. You know, not that you know, that there's anything wrong with that because they're different, but I think in the business you need a good variety of people. That's why you need your Rey Mysterios. That's why you need your Big Shows, and that's mm-hmm. why you need your Pat Owens.
And if you have too many, I think if you have too many of the big guys, they don't look as big.
That's exactly, you know, and it's so funny because that's exactly like my point that I always tell people. I'm like, I don't know why the WWE doesn't get that. Like, you need your big guys and you need your small guys, you need your fat guys, you need your skinny guys because you need to have that variety because it's like a carnival. It's like if you look on a basketball court, you don't understand how tall those guys are because they're all like 7 foot tall.
Right.
You know, you don't understand it until you stand next to them and they're standing next to like some woman reporter who's a former basketball player herself, and she's 6 foot, you know, but they're like 7 foot, you know, you don't even understand, so there's that comparison, so that's why you need every different shape and size, so, you know, but hopefully WWE will get that one day and get back into the swing of things of knowing that it's not just the land, it doesn't have to be the land of the giants for them to be successful. Because I think if anything, I think it's that versatility of having your big guys. And, you know, having your big guys, your heavyweights, fine. But then also have your cruiserweight. The cruiserweight division can be great. So can the women's division. So can the tag team division. I mean, you could have so many different things going on that would make it different, you know? Mm-hmm. But it's where they want to put their effort and where they want to put their attention. And that's cool. I mean, Vince McMahon's toy. He'll play with it how he wants, right?
Right. You brought up the Boogeyman before. And whenever anyone brings him up, I always have to bring up my idea. For the gummy worms. Now, the guy eats worms. This would be the perfect thing to sell in the arenas. All the kids would buy them. Bags of gummy worms.
Yeah, sure. Like a dirt pie. Like, you know, you've got the Oreo, crushed up Oreos with
right,
gummy worms
right.
in it.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I totally agree. And you know, there's no reason why they shouldn't. I mean, hey, why not find another way to make money, right?
Right.
That'd be great for the Boogeyman. I love the Boogeyman.
Yeah, I told that to Al Snow and Eric Langley and I don't know, every guest I think we've ever had on until now.
Yeah, I mean, why not, right? Well, hey, well, I'm no different, Ben, and I'm sure you'll tell the next guy.
You got any upcoming appearances you want to let everybody know about?
You know, I'm appearing every day on MySpace. No, I...
Which is myspace.com/TankToland.
MySpace.com, TankToland.com, although I gotta fix that, so I gotta update my website, but basically, on MySpace, I'm always answering people's questions, and, you know, whether it be just wrestling questions or comments or suggestions or anything like that, or if they're wondering about training or anything like that, I'm more than helpful with answering questions. I'm all over the place, you know, so I'm here and there, and you know, just, I'm all over the independents, so, you know, I'm just having a good time doing that, so you can catch me wherever. Sometimes I put up my calendar of dates where I'm going to be, so if you're wondering where I'm at, you can just check my MySpace account. I guess it's MySpace.com/TankToland.
MySpace.com/TankToland.
Is that how it goes?
That's
shit,
okay.
One and one never fought. No, no wonder I only have 1,000 friends. Damn it. Shit. I know I'm slacking. My girlfriend's got like 10,000 friends, and I'm like, oh, I'm slacking. Well, then again, you know, she's a little bit more popular than me, so whatever.
Is she currently in the WWE?
Yeah, she is. Yeah, huh. Jillian Hall.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's one of the most asked questions. Are you dating Jillian? You know, but yeah, we've been together almost 4 years. So.
Okay.
Yeah, sorry guys. Sorry if anyone's interested in or out there. So. You're gonna just have to keep using your hand. Well,
oh,
whatever
man.
Else you got.
Oh, man. You
figure
so.
Is this a family show?
I hope not.
Okay.
Not after what we were talking about earlier.
Yeah, so, I mean, yeah, so you know, that's my main plug, just my space, and you know, I'm doing wrestling as well as entertainment, so I do other little things here and there, commercials, and I'm actually getting ready to hopefully do a TV show, but we'll see. That's kind of still in the works and stuff, so we'll see what's going on with that, so things are going well, man, you know, huh? Things are going good.
Cool, you got any other questions from the board?
Extreme Falls wants to know if, while you were in the WWE on SmackDown, did you ever look back at your matches and just cringe at all the gay jokes coming from Taz and Michael Cole while you were trying to wrestle?
you know, I'm sure any of those jokes were more directed towards my more flamboyant tag team partner. it's all good. I mean, I knew as soon as I was told that I was going to be a dick, that there was going to be all kinds of jokes. I mean, right away when we had to do promos with oil and rubbing each other and stuff like that, I even said, isn't going to be kind of perceived as gay? And they're like, no. It's more like the guys hate you and the women love you, you know? It's kind of like you guys are, I'm like, okay, if that's how you see it, sure. You know? I'm like, ah. I'm pretty sure I've seen it in a different way, but hey, who am I? I mean, I'm not a writer, so I don't know, but whatever. You know, I just did what I was told, and when it came down to it, I knew Taz was going to, you know, rip the gay jokes, and that's all good. I like Taz, mm-hmm. You know, and Michael Cole, you know, and of course, Michael Cole, and he's a goofy bastard, and he's a nice guy, too, so, I mean, it's all good, it's all done in good fun, so, you know, let the gay jokes fly, you know, I know what I am in real life, I know who I go home to, you know, so, I'm not sure who Chad goes home to, but I know who I go home to, it's all good, though, I mean, whatever, you gotta do what you gotta do, right, if you gotta be a dick, you gotta be a dick, you know. I mean, I was just waiting for them to come out with a vagina so we could have a few big feud, but that never happened. You know? Yeah. I don't know if you remember, but we got this squirt of oil on an animal in his eyes, which is pretty silly, actually.
Yeah,
that's kind of gay. Yeah. So there's definitely some gay stuff going on there, but I guess you just got to do what you got to do, huh?
And I guess Big Dick Dudley kind of stole you guys' gimmick.
What's that?
I think Big Dick, is it Big Dick, not Big Dick.
Big Dick Johnson.
Big Dick Johnson stole you guys' gimmick.
Oh, Big Dick, I'll tell you what, anyone that wants to feel anything that had to do with a dick, good luck to you. I hope you can do better with it than I did. More power to you. I really hope anyone that wants that can have it, I would have paid to give it to him if I could have had another dick. But, you know, it's all good, man. It's all good. Let people be dicks if they want to be dicks.
Right. Well, Tank Toland's a much better name.
Yeah, I'd go with Tank Toland. It's more befitting of me. So, you know. So, it's all good. It's all good. But, so, you know, if you guys want to check me out at MySpace, go for it, bro.
All right. We'll put the link up on our site. Really appreciate you coming on tonight.
Yes, please do put the link to my site up there, please.
Yeah, I don't think you update your, there's also a tanktoland.com, but I don't think it's updated.
Yeah, that really sucks. I gotta actually get that fixed. It's either I gotta get a new web guy, and so if anyone else out there does web pages and stuff, you know, that's anyone that's listening, you know, if you want to contact me, if you want to do a web page for me, I might want to revamp that and do it. So, because that one's old and stagnant and stale. So let's get something new going.
All right. Anything you want to tell the fans out there before I let you go?
Yeah, just basically, you know, I appreciate all the support that all the fans have given me. Whether you love me or you hate me, you know, I appreciate the fact that you're just wrestling fans in general. And I think it's good that if it wasn't for, you know, all the fans out there, I wouldn't have a job. You know, well, I'd have a job, but it wouldn't be this job. And I'm actually able to do what I love because of them. And I appreciate all their support, whether they're cheering for me or booing me. And if you are booing me, and you're booing me because I was a dick, I could totally understand. But let me tell you right now, if you saw me in an independent match and you saw me the way I wrestle now, it's totally different from what I did in WWE. It's more intense and more of an international flavor, more closer to ROH now, Ring of Honor style, and it's a lot different. And I think you would like the Tank Toland that you see rather than the James Dick that you knew. But thanks. I just want to thank all my fans for all the support.
We really appreciate you coming on here.
I appreciate you guys having me on. Thanks a lot, man.
This is Jerry Lynn, and I'm going to create a sensation mongering at inyourheadonline.com.